Miami. South Beach, bring the heat. Can y'all feel that?
Live from Miami Beach in Southeast Florida. This is CFI Bootcamp with the Power Hour. Welcome. Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Power Hour. We're on about that. We've got a good one lined up for you today. So this is Multi-Engine Aerodynamics. And I've got the privilege of having a guest speaker with us, Hobie Tomlinson. And he was flew for TWA, and he's the multi-engine guru of SAFE, which is Society of Aviation Flight Educators. And I connected with him through David St. George, who's the director of SAFE. And we're going to let him chime in near the end to give you some expanded content. What I mean by that is insight, real insight, right? Which is really, really good. I mean, there's a lot of stuff wrong with multi-engine training, and I think he's a real good fixer for that. So that's how I'd start off with that. He'll chime in here about the right time. We have some things to go over. Before we get rolling here, I just wanted to run through a few things. Firstly, the Redbird Migration finished up. That was Tuesday and Wednesday. That's a flight training expo, and I attended that virtually. And it was a great conference, as usual. We weren't able to attend in person, but we will next year. I think it's back in San Marcos, Texas. So we'll all be back for that. And anyway, I learned a lot of good stuff. And actually, I wanted to give a big shout out to one of my peers in the industry. That's Eric Crump. So Eric, he's not in the room right now, but used to be with GLIME, and he wrote most of the syllabuses and stuff with GLIME. And he now heads up Polk State Aviation College in Lakeland as the director or the chair for that. And he did a conference on CFIs, and it was like Can't Fully Instruct, was basically how junior people are now, and there's not enough mentors around. And he mentioned something which I'd struggled with for a million years, right? 25 years, and I finally got it because of what he said. I know what it means, but what I wasn't able to get was the point. I couldn't articulate this well. So he said there's a difference between giving a ground lesson, maneuvers ground lesson, and a pre-flight briefing. And from that, I thought, well, that's what I've been wanting to say for 100 years, right? The pre-flight briefing is different than a full-on ground briefing. And all of our lesson plans that flight schools require you to make or want you to make as a flight instructor are centered not around a pre-flight briefing, but a full-on lesson plan. Then when you go ready to teach it, then what do you do? So I want to announce that we are now finishing another book. So you know we have our lesson plans book. And so we're stripping the maneuvers guide out of that now. That's going to be out. And we're putting that into something we call pre-flight briefings, which will be the pre-flight briefing. It'll be a whiteboard, and it'll be on the left-hand side. It'll have the maneuver, how to set everything up. On the right-hand side will be the artwork of what you want to put on the board for the 10 minutes you've got prior to the flight. And then the last thing, we've retitled the name of teaching private and commercial maneuvers to what to say in the airplane. That's what we call it now. And what that means is this is precisely what to say for every maneuver. It's what the British call the patter manual. And and that's been missing in our country for a long time. We'll do it for multi-engine, we'll do it for all of it. But what we're gonna do is tie these books together as one book, and it's gonna be clickable. So if you wanna do the ground lesson part of the steep turn, you click that, it brings up the full-on lesson plan for steep turns. If you then go, I just want the pre-flight briefing, you tap that, up will come just the pre-flight briefing. And if you just, what to say in the airplane, you tap that, it'll come up and it'll be landscape mode, so you can use it right on your iPad. So that's gonna be coming, and that's nothing in the industry been like that. We don't have anything like that. So really happy to be able to bring that to light. And I really wanna thank Eric Crump for making me see the light of day there. I could never articulate that, but now that helped me categorize that. Okay, anyway, there's that. And that's all I have to say about the announcement side. We'll show you what we're doing in terms of classes at the end. But for right now, I'd like to dive into the content of that. And so this is multi-engine aerodynamics. And what I intend to cover in a short amount of time is two engines. I'll talk about two engines and talk about the fact that's not always the best thing in the world. It can be, but losing one will certainly get your attention. And when you lose an engine because the engines are not on the center of gravity, there's going to be undesired yaw. And so you're going to have directional control issues, which you don't have in a single, right? When the engine quits, you typically go straight ahead. That won't happen in a multi-engine airplane. That's not centerline thrust. And then we'll talk about what a critical engine is. We'll determine what critical engine on your airplane might be. We'll define the VMC speed. So for the airplane, we'll say what that red radial line means and how it changes. It's not always the same speed. We'll talk about the danger of VMC decreasing with altitude in non-turbo piston airplanes. We'll give a shout out to the best rate of climb single engine and performance. It's a blue line on your airspeed indicator. And then we're going to talk about getting zero side slope, which is something you don't really have to worry about in a piston airplane or anything. So this is quite different than single engine training. So that's what I intend to cover. I know that's a lot. And then Hobie is going to chime in and take the rest of it. And then we'll join up at the end and I'll show you sort of what's going on with us. So two engines can be better, but not always, because when you lose an engine in a training airplane, 80% of the climb is lost with one engine due to drag. So you don't just lose 50% of your horsepower. You're losing about 80% of the performance. And in most training airplanes, climbing on a single engine is either very impractical or impossible or a little bit. So you don't get a lot of leeway with that. So the thing I most fear is that if I lose an engine in a Cessna and I want to land like a 150 straight ahead, I can hit the ground at about 30 knots, 30, 32 knots. But if I'm going to do that in a twin, I'm going to hit the ground a lot faster than that. And then the G-force that can be created and the trauma is a lot more. So when you hit the ground, you're going to be hitting it a lot quicker. And if there's a lost control due to directional control issues, it's even worse. So in training airplanes, I would tell people to be sure you're learning from an experienced MEI and someone who's very, very current. You need to stay really super current in multi-engine airplanes, because the reaction time and the training that you receive, that needs to be as quick as you can get it. So if there's a loss of control, you need to be right on it. And if you're out of currency, then you're not gonna have that. And that's where the problems, a lot of the problems begin. And the other is the academics not understanding what's going on. So here's the problem. A loss of a power plant causes a heading change, it causes yaw. And that's because the engines aren't aligned with the center of gravity. They're sitting out there on the wings, outward. And when an engine fails, then there's gonna be a yawing moment. There's gonna be a tendency for this airplane to want to now turn the airplane with the yaw around its center of gravity, because the other engine is no longer producing the thrust it was. So that's not good. And so what do you do? Okay, well, the yawing moment typically is stopped with rudder. So you smash in the rudder in the opposite direction and then you'll stop the heading change, and then you've got directional control again, right? But the rudder's effectiveness is a function of the airflow over it. So this means that if you're going really fast and you can stay going very fast, that if you press on the rudder, you get a particular amount of force, right? Due to the speed, but the slower you go, the more of it you got to put in. And the more of it you put in, you may not have enough if you get too slow, and then you lose directional control. So this is the end problem. And we'll do a little sketch here in a second to show you some of that. So let's look down a little farther and we'll talk about then what it means, critical engine. So this is defined in, and I do have to say that the current FA materials are getting worse instead of better in terms of the multi-engine side of things. I was researching to do this presentation a little bit. I wanted to see what's new, and I was in the current airplane flying handbook. And then I was so kind of like put back by why aren't they talking about anything here? Not anything, but some of the things that matter, that I went back to some of the previous versions of the handbook to see what they took out. And there was a lot, substantially a lot. And even the AC, which is flying light twins safely, is also a little bit lacking, right? So hopefully we're gonna write some content around that to shore that up. But anyway, they give you a definition of the critical engine, but they don't really say, they tell you in generally why, but no detail. So basically it's the engine that if it quits would have the most adverse performance on the airplane in terms of turning, in terms of this controllability, right? And so the reason that it happens is because of torque, P factor, slipstream, and you could say accelerated slipstream. Now these have been taken all out of the handbook. This is from a previous handbook. This is from the 04 version. But I think one thing you might be able to see in terms of just P factor first is that if you notice, this airplane's propeller will be turning to the right if both of these are turning to the right. And then this one to the right is going to produce more thrust on this side of the blade because it's descending. And that distance to the where the center of gravity is that far, right? If you look at this one that's also turning to the right, it's a lot closer to the fuselage. So if you lose this left engine right here, then this is going to be a bigger turning force in that direction. So this is the one you kind of want to keep if you to help you out. And in terms of torque, we can kind of look at that a little bit. But I also made this outline for you so you could actually study it offline and take a look. So I'm just going to create a little drawing here, and then I'll turn on the so you can see it. So let me create the drawing quickly, and then I'll turn this so you can see it. All right, I'm going to share the screen. Here we go with AirPlay. All right. Now you should be able to see it here in just about 5 seconds. So this is every MEI's nightmare is drawing artwork, but I made it quick. But here's an airplane that with the first one with both engines turning to the right. And so this engine is turning to the right, and so is this one. So the torque effect is that way, right? It's opposite to the direction that they're spinning. Now, if we lose the left engine, you still have the right engine turning to the right, but torque is now to the left, aiding in the turning force. But if you lose the right engine, you see that this is turning to the right. Now you have it turning to the left, which actually helps you. So this is how torque works. Now let's go back to the to the side of it. And why I'm here, I'm going to do a quick poll because I think we have enough people to be able to do it. Now we're just curious as to how you found us. Some of you I know, so. That I know you, but the rest of you, I kind of don't know where you came from. So I was just really curious, and it helps us because we're able to put some effort into that. So I'm going to put up this quick little poll and have you just click onto it in a second here. This one, and just sort of just click it, and then we'll gather the data and share it with you at the end. So here it is. How did you find out about the power out? And so Redbird migration. You come to our website, you did social media, you got a blast or an email or a notification from Safe, someone recommended it to you or something else. So as you click onto those, that would be really helpful for us to know, because then we can start putting time and effort into that. So far of you, about 45% of you have come directly from the website somehow, maybe from a Google search and then other quite big social media and Safe. Okay, so we're having that. And then I'll leave that open for just a second more. And then a slipstream. So if you look at the slipstream of this thing, how it produces slipstream, the left engine is able to hit the tail, which helps in the controllability of the airplane. Okay, I think that's probably, I think we're getting there. We'll let that go just a little bit more. 10 seconds or so. I think 40 of you have chimed in. The rest of you may not know, but that's okay. All right, so I'll end the poll now because that'll be enough. That's sort of representing what we want to do. Okay, thanks for that. And so anyway, just if you wanted to know, the 40% of you came directly to the website, 20 came from social media, 5% came from Safe, 5% was recommended by someone, Redbird migration was 3%, and other was about 28. Okay, so that's that. So now we know. All right, so let me just finish that. Now I need to move this out the way. All right, we should be back to the regular share now. Move this. Anyway, can you still see the poll results or no? Nicholas?
Yep, we can see them. We're good.
Can you kill them? Because I can't figure out how to turn them off.
Let me see.
Stuff. Didn't seem to be an easy way to do that. Okay, anyway, let's move on. Great. All right. So now let's move into the next little topic that I wanted to talk about here with the multi-engine aerodynamics. I still see them, so I don't know how to kill them. An accelerated slipstream is the area behind the nacelle here is being energized by the prop wash. And so that creates a similar thing as the P factor does. All right. Now let's talk about the big animal, which is the VMC. Are you able to kill the pole?
Say that again, Mike. I'm sorry.
Can you see the pole on the screen?
I can't.
Oh, you cannot. Okay, it's only me who sees it. All right.
No, I can't. I can't.
Can you kill it? I can't figure out how to kill it.
Yeah, you just need to exit out.
There, I don't see an exit on the thing. Maybe it's because the annotations are blocking the whole thing. I see. Got it. Okay. It's sometimes the laptop screen is not big enough. So, okay, let's carry on. So VMC, this is the speed at which the airplane will lose directional control. It means that basically you run out of rudder. You won't have enough rudder to stop the yaw, right? And this is a certification speed as well. So this means that all aircraft, multi-engine aircraft, are gonna have this red radio line here. And that radio line is specified, the conditions under which it's put on there is under part 23.149. And the thing to know is that the slower you go, the less effective the rudder is. And you get to a point where that other engine is still continuing to try to yaw the airplane and you can no longer stop it with the rudder. So the certification then goes into this. So it's the power plant side of things. So the way it was certified was the critical engine. In most cases, that's the left engine if they're both turning to the right. If on the Duchess and the Seminole, those are counter-rotating propellers. And so there's no critical, they provide equal damage, so to speak, right? So, but there's not one that's worse than the other. The critical engine is failing in windmilling. You have full power on the operating engine at sea level. So that means you have the most turning force, right? If you didn't have, if you wanted the quickest way to end VMC is to close both the throttles, right? No thrust means no yaw, right? That may not be desirable, but that would be a really quick way to stop VMC because you wouldn't have any adverse yaw from the other engine. And the worst case would be just put a big motor on it, bigger and bigger and bigger, and keep the rudder the same size. Now you have an enormous amount of thrust. You don't have enough rudder to overcome it, so that VMC speed would climb up higher. So this is certification. Then they allow the manufacturers to bank up to 5 degrees into the good engine, excuse me, or the operating engine, because what you're doing there is when you bank, you're essentially turning, but you're causing lift to go that way, right? And so you're opposing that lift, the horizontal component is opposing the turn. And so, but they don't want you to go like 30, 40 degrees and cheat. So they say, okay, 5 degrees is it. The rudder force can't exceed 150 pounds because, you know, maybe if it were 400 pounds, you couldn't even press it, right? So that'd be unfair. The configuration, landing gear is retracted. The flaps are in the takeoff position. The trim's in the takeoff position. The cowl flaps are in the takeoff or open usually position, out of ground effect. And then the weight of the airplane, it'd be at the most unfavorable weight. And we'll see in a second that would be the lightest weight. And the airplane would have the most rearward CG. So that's the conditions. And some people will call these the factors of it. There's a lot of things, but this is the certification criteria. And then we can look at those and say, well, how does each one, you know, how does it affect? So if the engine's not windmilling, well then, you know, there's less drag over there, right? So that'll improve the VMC. Full power, if we take power off the operating engine, that will bring the VMC number down as well. If we don't bank into the engine, then we're gonna have a higher VMC speed. And landing gear, if we talk about that, the landing gear acts as sort of, when they're down, as stabilizers, right? Like a rudder, like a water rudder. And so it keeps the airplane more stable. The flaps and takeoff are just so there's no competitive advantage between us. Like I may have an airplane would do this a lot better if the flaps were at 30 degrees, but we would never take off with them at 30 degrees. We'd take off at zero. So the FAA says, well, you can't really use, you know, the 30 degree thing because that's not practical for the takeoff condition. So we really want to simulate the takeoff condition. So these trims, so it's not as to put extra trim in to maybe increase the, if the airplane is so equipped, the surface of the of the rudder or the turning force of it or whatever it might be. The CG here is an interesting one, so I can show you. So you can notice that if the CG is forward, that you're turning an airplane, yawing it with the rudder, and you're yawing around the CG, right? The airplane's axis. And so if that CG is farther back for a same given amount of thrust out of the engine, you have less moment here on the rudder to work with. And so you're not going to be able to provide as much force to counter that yaw, which is turning the airplane that way, right? So that's what that means. So so an important thing, this red radio line that we see on the airspeed indicator really is just the certification speed. And it is not the VMC speed for your condition today, right now, most likely, right? It's most likely going to be a different speed. And so then what speed is it? Well, you know, you can't calculate it, but you can know if it's changing and how it's changing. So you can say, well, this would make it a lot worse and this would make it a lot better. But the end effect is what will happen if you were to lose an engine or purposely or in training and then start slowing the airplane down and trying to hold a heading, you would notice that at some point you will run out of rudder. You will not have enough rudder to cause the airplane not to yaw any longer, and it will roll off and lose directional control. And the only solution for that is, well, you've got two or three things you can do. The first thing you want to do is push the nose down, right? Because you want to get the speed up. You want to get above the VMC speed. And in training, sometimes we would say to pull both throttles to idle. And this is where the training side is very important, because if this happens to you on takeoff and you are in an airplane that could possibly climb on a single engine, and your training was such that that you would just close the throttle, well, you're going to descend and maybe stall, right? So, but if you have enough training and enough forethought, what you could do is you could notice you're losing directional control and then stick forward, but keep the throttle where it is. You could do that. And you would have some directional control and you would be at the limit of your performance then. The other thing about this VMC speed, it doesn't guarantee you any climb. It doesn't, none of that. This means that it only guarantees that if you're above the speed, the real speed, that you'll be able to maintain directional control. You'll be able to basically go straight ahead. That's what you're getting. And if you do have to crash into something, you definitely want to do that in control. So that's what that means. So let's move on to this part. So this is how VMC decreases with altitude. Again, you cannot find this. You will not find this in the airplane flying handbook currently. But understand that as the airplane, when the airplane is at sea level, when the density altitude is low here, all right, the indicated airspeed, this indicated airspeed, here's the real VMC speed. And so this means that at when this, and as you keep going up in altitude, the engine's performance becomes less, right? Because the density of the air is less. And so the turning that actually yaw that's going to be caused if the engine fails is going to be less, right? In fact, if you think about it, if you went all the way up to where both engines quit, if you get that high, then you would have no VMC. So the VMC is caused by the operating engine causing yaw. And so at this point, below this particular altitude, the critical altitude right here, you will see a loss of directional control first. So as you get slower and slower and slower, the airplane, you keep putting in more and more rudder, then what will happen is keep stopping it. Then eventually what will happen is at that magic speed, the airplane, the VMC speed, the airplane will then yaw, right? When you go below that. But if you get high enough where the other airplane or the good engine is not producing the thrust it was down here, you can get into a place where the turning force is such that you get to the VMC speed and you can go slower and slower and slower because that yawing is not enough and you can actually stall first. So you get the stall warning horn or you get the actual stall first. And if you have stall with yaw, I think you probably know what that means. That means you're going to spin the airplane or you're going to have a potential to spin the airplane. And none of these twins have been certified for spinning. Now there's been extensive work that was done on the Duchess and on the Baron for spinning. In fact, you can go on YouTube and you can see those very, they did spin training in the Duchess and it actually spun very conventionally. Even with the operating engine into the spin and the opposite way, they tried everything. They put a parachute on the thing and then at the very end of it, at the back, they said, well, maybe the parachute, the boom is providing stability. So take it off. Can you imagine? I want to be in there, okay? I'm not going to be that guy. I am not that brave. So they did that, and they found out that if you use the spin recovery procedure, the emergency one that was in the handbook actually worked every time. But don't rely on that. You know, the idea is know enough about this so you don't get anywhere near that to begin with. Don't be an idiot is what we say, right? And part of it comes with training, and part of it comes with the depth of knowledge and understanding, as opposed to just the go do it and feel it. Everything in the world can't be done by feel, right? You can't learn everything there is to know about aviation and being safe by feel. When the airplane, when the jet starts to lose systems and starts to blink, red lights and yellow lights and all kinds of lights, I'll tell you who you don't want next to you. The person next to you, you don't want that to be the best stick and rudder pilot in the world who doesn't have any sense about the systems on the airplane. You want the guy who understands the systems on this airplane like crazy. That's knowledge, right? So there's stick and rudder skills, and there's this kind of skill. And this kind of skill, don't underestimate it. Okay, now let's look at this speed called VYSE and performance. So this is the best rate of climb on a single engine. It's listed with a blue line right here on your airspeed indicator, right? And this is the speed at which, if you have an engine in operative, you'll climb at the best rate of climb. It's indicated at sea level, full gross weight, and it's also at zero side slip. So you say, now what's that? Because we didn't talk about that yet, right? So that's the last thing we'll talk about. So basically you hear this called blue line, right? So, and in training, they might say something like, if you lose the engine, go to blue line. That's what that means. Or don't go below blue line in the traffic pattern until you're on final and the airplane's configured to land, right? They might say that, the single engine. So here's what the deal is with a multi-engine airplane. If all you do is put the rudder in to stop the yaw, what will happen is the airplane will begin to sideslip. And you notice where the relative wind is over here, right? Well, that's the way the airplane's going. Yes, the wings are level, the heading is constant, but the airplane is sliding due to side slip over this way, and this destroys climb performance. So if you were to have an engine failure like this, and you kept the ball in the middle, what would happen is you would side slip like this, right? That's what would happen. So the idea would be, well, wouldn't it be nice to eliminate that side slip? That'd be kind of a good idea, right? And how can we do it? We can do it by banking into the good engine, because we can move this vector more forward, because we can direct lift to the right. And so if we do that, then this is what happens. So here we have about, there's an incorrection. It says about 5 degrees. It's 2 to 3 degrees as Hobie made sure I understood to tell you, right? And this will then bring the relative wind straight ahead. And then we'll have better climb performance and the airplane won't side slip. And also it'll be about a half ball out. We really don't have a way to measure it precisely, unless the only way we could do it is if we put a string like from here called a yaw string, just the yarn, and put it, taped it on and put it here. If we could make the string straight, then that would be zero side slip. And then we could see that. But because we can't measure that, this is our best approximation, and it's not terrible. So that's that. Now, a few other things I wanted to bring out just before I give you, these are the references currently. So let's go to the, I just wanna go back to the little drawing, because I wanna show you one thing here. And these factors up here about VMC. So what I wanted to do is talk about the weight side of it, because it's a bit misunderstood. So let me turn on the share, and then I'm going to turn it over to Hobie here in just a second. Do that. All right, so give me a second till I get this. I'll do the drawing as we go, so you don't have to wait on it. Okay, we see that. That's good. Now let's make a new one. Okay, now we should go bring that up. And now we have a piece of paper here. All right, so when the airplane, if you have an airplane that's at a particular weight, let's make it turn, right? Airplane turning, and it has a particular weight. You generate lift to counter the weight of the airplane. And then when it turns by this force, right? Which is the horizontal component of lift. It's centripetal force as well. The same thing, it's that force that is helping the airplane turn. In a multi-engine airplane, when you bank, you're directing lift in this direction to help you not yaw, right? Over in this direction, so it doesn't yaw, to help you with that. Now, imagine which would be better, you know, a higher or a lower weight configuration for that. So let me change the pin color. And let me just change the weight, you know, and that changed the lift, and that changes this. And that means there's more horizontal component of lift available to throw in to counter the yaw, So the heavier the weight, the easier it is to control. And if you can't quite follow that, the other way, which is dead easy to remember, is the heavier something is, the more inertia it has and the more momentum it has, and the more it wants to resist a change of flight path. So you think about the idea of a crosswind landing in a piston airplane. So let's go back to the share and think about how you would do it. What you shouldn't do is you shouldn't follow this idea that you crab all the way down to the ground in the last second, then somehow you push this crab out, because when the wheels touch, you're going to be drifting, right? You're not controlling the drift. And so then what would happen is the tire is going to skid. So the idea is somehow you have to transition from a crab, if you're going to do that, we should do that, into a side slip. And then that allows you to not skip. But if you think about a big airplane, a very large, heavy airplane, you don't need to do that. And it's not, and the engine's too low to the ground anyway. So you do, you push that, you make the, because it's so heavy and has so much momentum, it's just going to go that way for a while. And the speed of the airplane is such that the landing speed is very high relative to the crosswind component. So therefore the drift angle is low, low-ish. So that's the idea there. So you can say, well, it just resists change is what you would say for the VLC. All right, now I've said my piece. First, I want to tell you this, the references. It's the Airplane Flying Handbook, the latest one. It's really thin on the multi-engine aerodynamics. It's kind of, it's not my favorite thing. There is an AC here, and it's actually a flight test guide. And it basically says, this is how you determine VMC and the parameters that are set up to do it. And on page 70, it determines, you can look and see what the criteria is. This is the regulation that specifies the criteria. And then this is this is an FAA publication. It's FAA PEAT publication, and it's called Flying Light Twins Safely. And those are your resources until we make more. On top of that, one of the things we're trying to do with our power hours is, and going forward with our alliances with SAFE and NAFI and whoever will listen, is Hobie brought out this point that there's tribal knowledge. And a lot of the stuff that he's going to talk about, the stuff that was in previous handbooks is gone. Like, for example, the steep spiral. You know, why is it the only ground reference sort of performance that's done upwind? You know, and where is the talk about lowering the nose attitude when the bank angle is higher? That's all gone, right? It's not in the latest handbooks. And so what we're trying to do is assimilate this tribal knowledge and publish it. And that's what we hope to share. And we can do that by video. We can do that by media. By paper, we can do it by a lot of things, but it's really easy to get it out on video first and then make something from it. So that's my preferred medium. Last things, these are the courses we have coming up. Then I'm gonna pass it over to Hopi here. There won't be any power hour next week. That's Halloween. I'll be dressed up like something. No, I'm kidding you. If you haven't noticed, I think maybe you'll notice that, have I ever had a different t-shirt on than this? No. Has this hat ever been any different? No. I have like 12 of these in the drawer. It's the same color, no matter. There's one with a collar, that's for weddings and funerals, right? and the rest of it is, and there's one suit in there in case I have to really go to a wedding or funeral. The rest of the time, it's this all the time. So consistency. So I'm dressing as me. I'm going to be me, I think, which is really hard to be. And then on November 7th, we're going to talk about how to teach VR navigation to your students. The class that's coming up next week, the week is the initial class in, a CFI class in Palo Alto. It's sold out. The only thing there is one, I think, one more live stream seat for that. There's also a double I class on the 9th through the 11th. That'll be in Palo Alto and also Opa-locka. And then the initial class, last one of the year, will be the 7th to the 13th in Palo Alto and Opa-locka. And there's some, I think there's now three seats left, plus three live streams. And we're going to do CFI Insights at a different time. We're still struggling a bit with the content and what we want to put in there. But this might be some of this tribal knowledge. I think that might be a place, and we'll maybe bring in some other people for that in that 5-hour period and let them shine and let them bring what they really know to life. Okay, so I'm going to be quiet now, and I'm going to let Hobie talk. Hobie, you're on my, you're off your, can you hear and can you talk?
Hey, can you hear me? Can you hear me okay?
We hear you fine. So I'm going to go ahead and not share the screen. So I'm going to make it so that, so you'll be able to do that if you want to. If you don't want to, that's okay. But I'm going to stop sharing the screen. That way you'll be full size, lifelike, so to speak. All right, you've got the floor. Go ahead and we'll tell you, give you like the 2-minute warning. Nick will, okay? Go ahead and
All right, sounds good. Well, let me introduce myself. I'm Hobie Tomlinson. I'm up in Burlington, Vermont, kind of the far spoke of the aviation world up here. But as Mike said, Mike gave you some excellent content here. And what I'm going to try to do is talk about some practical application. I got my initial CFI in 1965, so I'm an old guy. I've been a DPE since 1977. As Mike said, I spent 37 years in the airline world with TWA and American Airlines, 14 years in the training department. So the multi-engine training has been kind of my passion, I guess, as I try to get out of the airline. I flew corporate for a while and at 135 charter organization. And then I just decided I would when that all died, become an independent instructor. I've been was safe since the beginning. I've been to MCFI since 2003. So I've flown a lot of multi-engine airplanes. Actually, last year I just passed 40,000 hours. Believe it or not, other people had lives. I flew airplanes, but about 24,000 hours of that was in the airline world, and the other 16 was in GA, almost half split between singles and twins. But I've done a lot of work with twins, it's an area I think that the industry has not done a good job with, because we do these fast ratings and people don't get an understanding of all the things can affect you with a multi-engine airplane. But let me start out by saying there's really two kinds of multi-engine airplanes out there. There's a Part 23 airplane, which is what we're talking about. Those are the normal category airplanes. There's a Part 25 airplane, which is a transport airplane. The difference is the transport airplane has guaranteed performance. So there's no place in that flight profile where you cannot safely lose an engine and safely fly the airplane or stop the airplane. We go to Part 23 airplanes, we have kind of a gap. And the reason is Part 23 airplanes don't have to have guaranteed performance. And notably, they can't climb during the gear retraction cycle, what we call first segment climb, which is why you don't see accelerate go on Part 23 airplanes. And they don't even have to have guaranteed climb performance. They have to state what it is. I mean, for the old people around among us here, if you remember, the Champion at one time decided they were going to put two engines on the Champ and make it a multi-engine trainer. And they built the Lancer, which is infamous because it only flew in one engine one way downhill. That obviously wasn't successful. A lot of the multi-engine training happens in the lower powered airplanes and their more marginal performance. But as Mike said, the big thing when you lose an engine is you have 20% of your climb performance available. And what does that mean to us? Well, if we took just to put that in perspective, if we took a typical twin and we said, okay, we're going to blue lines just to make easy numbers, say blue line was 120 knots and they climbed 200 foot a minute. That means we're doing 2 miles a minute and it's going to take us 5 minutes to climb to pattern altitude. So what that means is if we lost an engine at low altitude, we would reach pattern altitude 10 miles from the liftoff point. And a lot of people don't think about that. So the flight profiles with some of these airplanes and airports we're using at, you have to think about where am I going to go if an engine fails. Now, one of the things with these airplanes, you know, when we do flight testing in multi-engine airplanes, the FAA's put some safety guidance out. I mean, we're not supposed to, we have a hard floor of 3000 AGL. Some of the airplanes like the Barons want you above 5000 AGL. So we're going to be higher altitude. The other thing is that with the small airplanes, we have an area that they call it the area of decision. In other words, from the point where we no longer can safely stop on the runway to the point where the gear is up and we're out of 400 feet or 500 feet AGL, depending on the test we're doing, then we wouldn't do any engine failures in the airplane. However, in the real world, you might have them. And the area of decision is an area we talk about quite a bit, but it happens fairly fast. So one of the things we talk about on multi-engine airplanes is everybody emphasizes speed, but accuracy is far more important than speed. You actually, the old saying was think, then act, don't react. You know, it was interesting. NASA years ago did it. When they were starting with the astronaut program, they wanted to check reaction times. And so they built a box with a red light and a green light, and they had a little clicker. And when the green light went to red, they're supposed to punch the clicker and see what the reaction time was. And they brought a bunch of administrative people in, and they brought a bunch of test people in. And when they got the results, they were amazed because all of the test pilots had ostensibly longer times before they pushed the button than the office people. And what they finally found out was the test pilots had figured out before they did something, they wanted to think about what they were going to do. And the old, talking about tribal knowledge, the old people used to always say, wind your watch. But the bottom line of that is think, then act, don't react, because reaction sometimes can be wrong. And there's always time to do it right, but there's not always time to do it wrong and fix it. So in the takeoff part, the first thing we talk about is the abort. And one of the things when we look at performance in multi-engine airplanes, we're looking at takeoff distances. There's three things we have to look at. On all civil airplanes, the landing distance actually is the shortest of the three. The next is the takeoff distance. And what really defines light twins is accelerate stop distance. So that means that is the fastest speed I can reach and stop on the remaining runway. And what you're going to find with most light airplanes around the East Coast, if you get the accelerate stop, usually is the critical one, and it can run from slightly above 3 up to about 4,000 most piston twins. So on the abort phase, you know, we have a thing called VMCG, which means that is the minimum speed I need to control the airplane on the runway with an engine failure. And in fact, we don't talk about that a lot. The difference is the engine failure, I have no bank capability, number one. And number two is when they do it, they're not supposed to use nose wheel steering. And lastly, the crosswind affects the VMCG, because obviously the airplane wants to yaw into the wind. And if the engine, upwind engine fails, then it's going to be a lot harder to control. When we do those on flight tests, we have to do that abort less than 50% of VSO, so there's no chance to get the airplane in the air. The abort is most critical at low speeds, and usually when I'm teaching aborts, first of all, you want to brief an abort before you ever do it, because the airplane's out of control until you close the throttle. So I teach my instructors when I pull a mixture, and usually I do that with a mixture on a piston, when I pull a mixture, you know, I reach right up and put my hand over the student's hands. If the throttles aren't closed, I close them, because you don't have long to deal with it. But the slower that happens, the more dramatic it is. So as Mike wisely said, at low speeds and slow, lighter weights, the airplane is more dynamic. Weight is a stabilizing effect, so it's going to maneuver quicker. So one of the things we teach is hands on the throttles. I see people in twins take their hands off the throttles. As a matter of fact, if in the old days, he did that in a single. The old instructors weren't much on touchy-feely. They would explain how stupid you were, slightly above the threshold of pain. So that was usually a memorable occasion. But hands on the throttles until you reach for the gear lever. And one of the things, sometimes in some of the twins, they have rather low rotation speeds, like VMC plus 5. The most critical thing in a light twin is trying to get the thing to climb on one engine, and the more energy you have, if you have the runway length, the more engine energy you have when you take off, the better off you are. So one of the things I always teach is I have people rotate at VXSE minus 5. So the airplane comes in here at VXSE. Now, VXSE is, you know, most civil airplanes, you can't get behind the power curve. And behind the power curve means that I'm not capable of accelerating level flight. That was one of the problems with the little Grumman Yankees, is you get them slow and they wouldn't accelerate level flight. If you did that low, you had problems. But at VXSE, most twins will accelerate level flight. So I rotate at VXSE minus 5. Your plane comes off the ground. Now here again, there's a difference between complex singles and twins. in the twin, the minute you're off the ground, I mean, to get one off the ground and have an engine failure and re-land, that's what people talk about. But think about this. I mean, first of all, it's a dynamic event. The airplane's not going to be lined up with a runway. You can't just close the other engine or it'll stall. I mean, there's all kinds of things. So once you're airborne in a twin, you want to think about flying and get the gear up. And what we're trying to do is narrow the time between rotation, which is the last point we really can successfully do an abort, to 400 feet where the airplane should go. Now, 400 feet is kind of a magic number because that was the old Pistons. They had a 5-minute takeoff power limit, and that's about where they could get to. If you ever watched a Connie or DC-7 take off, it's not like the jet. It sort of levitates. So we try to narrow that window so that we can fly at 400 feet. That's typically circling altitude. We should be able to, even if we can't climb a lot, should be able to maneuver back around the airport. So one of the things, when it's airborne, you know, runway's falling away, positive rate of climb, altimeter's increasing, then the gear goes up. When I take my hand off the throttle, I don't put it back on the throttle. I put it behind the throttles because sometimes if an engine failure surprises people and their hands are on the throttle, they yank the power back, not what you want to do. So all airplanes have control speeds and performance speeds, and the performance speeds are always above the control speeds. So performance speed would be our blue line, VYSE, control speed would be back when I'm running into VMC. And we talked about that's a condition, not a speed. And it depends on the bank angle. So once we get the gear up, then airspeed above VYSE is kind of wasted. What we want to do is minimize the time to 400 feet. So we want to climb at VYSE. I would climb to pattern altitude because they say the most likely chance of an engine failure is when you move the throttle back and change all the stresses on it. So there's two reasons we want to climb at VYSE. First of all, the drag increases as the square of the airspeed. So the drag of a windmilling propeller will kill excess airspeed or excess kinetic energy will be lost almost instantaneously, where potential energy of altitude is not lost, and it gives us maneuvering. So we're going to take it at VYSE up to pattern altitude, then we can transition to a cruise climb. Now, if we lose an engine, one of the things we talk about is on emergency checklist, we have memory items and read and do items. But the big thing I talk about, anytime I lose an engine, don't worry about which engine it is. You have to do two things. Just keep it straight with the rudder and put the nose down, probably 5 degrees. The nose needs to be about 5 or 7 degrees of pitch, and that'll keep your blue line speed. You want all your energy or performance loss to come out of vertical speed, not out of airspeed. And then once we've done that, one of the things people get nervous, they start doing things fast. It's very methodical. Put the nose, keep it straight, put the nose down to 5 to 7 degrees. And I used to tell students sometimes will push with both rudders because they're nervous. Just take one foot off the rudder. And then there's no question which one you're pushing on. Then slowly close the throttle on the foot that's on the floor. That verifies it. Bring the prop back slowly. Any changes, any configuration, noise changes, you got the wrong lever. But if I get the throttle back and the prop back, then pull it through the gate. Mixture cut off, flaps up, gear up, and off we go. If, in fact, VMC is defined by amount of rudder, basically, and you always want to have some rudder available. Now, the other thing is that, as Mike said, the engine is running, there's really three airspeeds on that wing. Behind the engine is running, we have the airspeed of the fuselage plus the energy of the thrust. Behind the engine is windmilling, we have a loss of energy caused by the windmilling propeller taking energy out of the airstream. So there will be some on any propeller airplane with wing-mounted engines, there's going to be some aileron deflection, but you never want to control yaw with ailerons. It's always with the rudder. And if the rudder gets to stop, just lower the nose. I mean, that the rudder authority is defined by the airspeed. And if we're holding blue line, we should be able to be fine with the airplane. And off we go with it. So what we're talking about is cockpit discipline here, that we can manage manage the airplane, and we have a very methodical process to go through. Now, different airplanes are going to have different performance. On the other thing you need to know about the airplane is where my single engine ceiling is. And there's a couple things on a departure with a twin. One is that, you know, if I'm doing, and Mike and I discussed this the other day, if I'm doing an instrument departure, then to fly an instrument profile, I have to have an airplane that will do a 3.3% climb gradient, 200 foot per nautical mile, which, if there again, we use a hypothetical blue line of 120, that means I have to have, and how you do rate of climb is you divide your airspeed by 60, what's 120 by 60 is 2 times the foot per nautical mile, means I have to make 400 foot per minute. So on most light twins, you're not going to be able to continue an instrument profile on one engine. So we have to have, okay, where am I going to go? Where's my low profile escape route? Now the higher, once I get to altitude, or I get some altitude, I have a lot more choices. The other thing is, depending upon what my ground level is, do I have single engine ceiling above the terrain? If I'm out west in a normally aspirated airplane, none of these airplanes would stay above ground level. So we talk about diversion and drift down to a landing. Lastly, if for some reason, once I have this engine failure in this area of decision between rotation and 400 feet, and the airplane is not going to fly, so we configure it for flight and we see what it's doing. But if I have terrain ahead of me and it's not going to fly, I don't want to, and I have to make it off-field landing, I don't want to do that at a high airspeed. So I would reconfigure with gear and flaps once I have my suitable landing area and slow it back up. Now, as I slow it up, I have to reduce the power. And basically, there again, I just have to bring the throttle back so I'm not out of rudder. You see these, the last thing I want to talk about is this snap roll event that you can get if you start using ailerons for yaw control. And that is, it's not possible with a rudder only to develop a side slip angle sufficient to stall the vertical stabilizer. Now, the vertical stabilizer is an airfoil just like propellers and wings. If I develop an extreme side slip angle, it's possible to stall the vertical stabilizer, which is like centering the rudder, and the airplane will snap over on its back. And that is very violent. I'm sure if you've seen some of these accidents, you'll see the airplane at the last minute snap over. And the reason is that it happened is that they're trying to control yaw with ailerons rather than bringing the power back. When you're out of rudder, then you have to bring the power back. So I'm going to stop it with that. I just want to talk about that's kind of a takeoff profile briefing here, and I don't want to run people over. So Mike, if you have some questions, I would stop here. It's a good stopping point. And you and I have talked, we may do some more later on. This is kind of a subject near and dear to my heart because I don't think it's given adequate training in the field and a lot of things. The last thing I would say is if you get in a multi-engine airplane, as Mike said, knowing the systems is very critical. Some of the fuel systems are all different on different airplanes, and some of them, like in the 400 Cessnas with aux tanks, I mean, that's critical. A lot of the engine failures are fuel, not fuel exhaustion, but fuel starvation induced because of mismanagement of the fuel system. So that's kind of a critical thing to know. Let me stop there and see if there's any questions, Mike. I'll turn it back over to you, and thank you for giving me my few minutes to say my piece.
Oh yeah, for sure. So we'll have contact information up for you later, but I wanted to, there were some things in the chat I wanted to say. I think they were good. And then if anybody has any specific questions, we have some minutes, just put them in the chat. So the first thing, which I thought was really good, was from Chip, was there's an appendix now on the FAA website that supplements the material that was inadvertently removed from the multi-engine section of the airplane flying handbook. So right after this, I'll be in that. And then the other is there's a newer version, a reg on controllability. It's 23.2135. So we'll have a look at that. That's some great catches. So that's really good for that. So what our intention is to create another power hour that's specific to the stuff that that Hobie's talking about, and we'll produce an outline for that so that you have it. And if you don't quite follow the whole thing, during when it's being said, and maybe you're going to do multi-engine stuff maybe a little bit later, whatever it is, you'll still have that to refer to. And then we'll put some content, package some content around that at some point. But I think the idea of keeping it a video, we're trying to make the Power Hours sort of like a, starting to make them more like a podcast in the sense that, yes, there's a topic, but I think there are some other experts outside of myself. I don't know how big of an expert I am, but enough of one to be able to give you a lot of information. But there are many, many people in our industry through SAFE, that's Society of Aviation Flight Educators, by the way. It's CFIs and educators, a group that's a nonprofit. There are plenty of people around who have plenty of things to say that you all could benefit from. And we want to keep that all free, and we want to all keep that with as many people as we can. We are getting wings credit coming. We should have it here in November. That's the latest from from Nick, who's been working on that with the two FISDOs, San Jose and South Florida FISDO. So that'll also be a little boost there too. But the idea is to turn that turn the Power Hours into, yes, that, but it doesn't have to just be me. It can be whoever is the expert in the room at whatever they're the expert in the room at. And I think that does so much, that's a better presentation. So we've done about 14 of these or so far. We are gonna start turning off the access to the library, which was the previous ones, because we're building up. I think that's the intent, right? So I think that's the intent. But at any rate, so if you don't have access to that, you know, make sure you download those videos or whatever you want to do with them before we shut off. Well, I don't think we'll shut off access to people who have them already. I think or access to that site. But going forward, I don't think we're going to offer that. I don't think. We may host some of those videos on Safe site if they like them or whatever it is. So we need to work through that. But the idea is we want to use this particular time, which we like. We like the noon to one in the East Coast. That's kind of lunchtime. And we like the fact that it's not too early for the West Coast as well. So great. So that's some good comments here. Thanks much for the content. That's from Kongi. Jeff, it says, it's a great lesson, a great session. The guest speaker was amazing. Thank you. So those of you who have multi-engine ratings, I think you gained a lot of benefit from hearing what he had to say. For those of you who don't have multi-engine ratings or are looking for it, you may have been lost a little bit with some terminology, but that's okay. This is recorded. You can watch it when you get your multi thing, and we'll have Hobie back for sure to do much more, not just, I gave him like 15, 20 minutes, and he performed right in that amount of time. So he's good like that, right? So, but we'll give him as much time, I think, as he needs at some point. Okay, this guy, so Rachel is saying she's studying for her MEI currently, and there's some key items that were articulated differently, and she greatly appreciated it. So great, there we were able to help some people today, and that's kind of the whole purpose of this. Again, my purpose, of course, is we want to get a giant list, and eventually you'll buy shit from us, or not, right? That's the kind of the thing, right? You'll say, oh, you guys kind of know what you're doing, you know, surrounded by some nice people, sounds like a good place to go. But if you never do, it doesn't matter. It matters that we also use the forum to reach out to people and give good information that may not be so readily available. Last thing I'll say is this good session from Darcy. And reminder, great, I'm glad I joined. Thanks, Hobie. Good takeaway on keeping the hand behind the throttle versus on the throttle. So there you go. You're getting some feedback from there. I don't think there's any questions as much as there was just, I'm completely mesmerized with what he's telling me now because I've never heard that before, but that's so incredibly useful. I think that's, people sink in. I'll be like, I want to hear that guy again. He'll tell me, you be quiet. Let him talk more. I think that's the idea, right? Okay, so next week, no Power Hour. So join that member site that we have that's free and then watch some of the Power Hours that you didn't get a chance to attend live for next week. That's your homework assignment. And then go find that supplement to the Airplane Flying Handbook that says the stuff to the lady, which obviously they did. And let's look at that. And then next time we're going to talk about teaching VR navigation. And I've got a great simulation tool for that you can download from the App Store for like $5 or $9. And it's fantastic. So that's your teaser for them. So let's see, how often would you guys suggest a multi-engine pilot obtain, is it recurrent training as you're asking for, Todd? How often would you guys suggest a multi-engine pilot obtain? Oh, multi-engine training. I guess that's a good question. Do you have something to say about that, Hobie?
Yeah, I mean, basically in the professional world, you do it every 6 months. And I think that's probably, certainly once a year. But I, you know, if you can do it every 6 months, I mean, it's just That would be kind of the gold standard for the industry.
Okay, I got that. And then I'm gonna. You wouldn't mind if people would want to come to you for multi-engine training, would you, Hobie?
Absolutely not.
And, put the contact details in chat here. So it would be Hobie, HOBIETW at. I forgot it. What was the last bit?
It's att.net.
Net. So if you want to reach out to him. And if you're going up by Burlington, Vermont, if you want to go up that way and get some multi-engine training, or maybe we could convince him to come to Miami when it's really cold up there. We might be able to do that too and put together something. That'd be great. So reach out to him for that kind of things. I don't think he'd mind at all. And I would love to do some flights with that guy. So anyway, there you go. And he's got more time than me, which is really good. And he's not complaining about it either. Did you notice? 40,000 hours, he didn't have any complaints about it. I kind of hate him already. All right, that's it. Thanks, guys, for showing up. I'm going to go ahead and check out. Gary Weaver, thanks for the thumbs up there. And that's it. And the EASA requires a check ride every year, the UK. That's true. The last comments. Okay, so you guys, thanks for attending the Power Hour. And give us a little next time when you log in. Tell us if you like the old theme music or you like the new Miami music. I'm not sure which works, but or if any of it works. But we're going to go ahead and terminate the meeting now so everybody can go do what they need to do. And that's the end of it. So now I need to end. So see you guys later. Bye-bye.